First, let me just say, my name is Aaron Vega. I'm the state rep from the city of I'm one of those state reps that actually answers all his emails and phone calls, which is how I make every lunch. Found out about this amazing idea, and I'm just glad to be part of it. Glad to see just 2 months, basically, two, 3 months that you were able to pull this off. So congratulations to you and all the hard work and all the people that helped you all bring this together. So I'm going to do this just a little bit differently. I'm going to talk for 1 or 2 minutes, and then I'm going to invite our panelists up one at a time, and then we're going to have them speak, and then we're going to get into Q&A, which is actually the most interesting part of this. So let me just say a couple quick things. Representing the City of Holyoke is really great, and it's an exciting time. I wore my constitutional tie. It felt like the right tie to wear, as opposed to my Jerry Garcia ties. And things are always interesting in Holyoke, but as we actually, at the state level, I think one thing that we should all be aware of, maybe you're already aware of it, maybe you've been hearing about it, but we are dealing with criminal justice reform. So yes, all right. So you see a lot of nodding heads. The Senate passed a what we call omnibus bill. The House just put forth the omnibus bill that we're debating on Monday. As many of you know, the House tends to be a little more conservative than the Senate. With 160 members, trying to appease everybody is not easy, trying to get everybody on the same page. But I will say this, the House version that's come out is surprisingly great. We'll be debating on Monday and Tuesday, hopefully making some improvements. And then those two bills will go to what's called the conference committee, and hopefully something will be coming out in mid-January to early February that's really going to make a difference in a lot of people's lives. Court reform, bail reform, really talking about diversion programs, and a lot about the reentry programs, which I know is going to be something that we're going to talk about probably in this next panel. So getting to the panel, I actually wanted to keep the energy up. The singing was amazing, thank you. I tend to sing in my shower, my car, so I'm not going to sing in public too much. But I'm proud, I'm going to actually reverse the order a little bit. I'm actually going to have, since I'm going to take ownership and privilege to actually ask the Holyoke High students to come up first. They've got a little presentation, so I'm going to ask them to come up here, do their presentation, then they're going to sit back and Luke's going to join, and they'll join the panel, so they're all going to come up here. So come on up. Holyoke Palante Restorative Justice Group. Last year, this group was the recipient of the Carlos Vega Fund Social Justice Award Champions, and we gave $1,000 donations to the work they're doing. They're really trying, and I'm not going to step on their thunder what they're going to do, but they're really trying to change the climate in school when we talk about that prison, that school to prison pipeline. Really heading at it, facing it head on. So trying to make sure that those incidents that happen on school don't become entry into the criminal justice program, or into the criminal justice system, I should say. So I'm going to just, Luke's not even up with them, they're ready to roll, right? They're ready, they're ready. So, and I would just say one other thing, that you may have heard about their group a little bit in the news recently, and I just hope, you know, one of the ills of social media today, I think there's lots of great things with social media, but the biggest ill I see of social media is people knowing very little and talking very loud. I was one of the people that was at the presentation, that was at the Hispanic Heritage Celebration, and out of context, unfortunately, many people took things and created lots of waves that was just unnecessary. Doesn't mean there isn't a lot to be talked about in Holyoke. Obviously, with a population that's 50% Latino, with 90% of that being Puerto Rican, there was a lot to talk about. And this group is willing to talk and has created a table to have that conversation. So without further ado, I'm going to pass it over to these great young people from Holyoke.
We are very excited to share with you about the Philanthropy Justice Program at Holyoke High School today. Hi, my name is Mr. Zorostino Valle. I am in 10th grade, and I'm currently one of the Philanthropy Justice Group leaders.
My name is David Serrano. I am in 10th grade, and I am a Restorative Justice Group leader.
Alright, hi guys. My name is Marco Antonio Cino Jr. I am a junior at Holyoke High School, and I'm here to restore justice.
Hi, I'm Eliza. I'm am in the 10th grade and I'm not in the restorative justice. Oh, my bad. I left the restorative justice grade. I'm Sierra, I'm an 11th grader, I'm one of the 11th restorative justice grade leaders, and before I was in restorative justice, I thought that the youth didn't have a voice, and now that I'm in restorative justice, I know that we do.
Hi, I'm Emily, I'm a sophomore, I'm also a restorative justice peer leader. Before RJ, I didn't feel like a sense of community or home at school after. I feel like there is a constant family.
Hi, my name is Salas. I'm a freshman at William High, and I'm one of the restorative justice peer leaders. Before being a part of RJ, I was a bit scared of joining high school because I didn't know if I was going to be accepted.
Now that I am part of this group, I know I have a community that would love and support me. I'm Nath, with two Fs. I am a Palante Restorative Justice peer leader. I am in the 11th grade. And before Palante, I was trying to find a light in order to help people, and I guess when I joined Restorative Justice, it was the best way I can, you know, use my gift to help other kids stay in school and not being stripped away from their education.
Mm-hmm. Before I joined Palante, I didn't necessarily felt, you know, welcomed because high school is a very big place compared to my middle school, which is only one hallway. And so after I joined the program, you know, it gave me a sense of like warmth, and it gave me a place to like, you know, depend on when I was in high school, and it gave me friends, you know, I could hang out with and say hi to in the hallways instead of, you know, just walking by.
So before I started Restorative Justice, I was a bit of a knucklehead. Like, I was one of those kids who would just walk around school and start problems with everybody, you know. So that was fun for me. But that was before. Then, you know, ever since I joined, you know, I matured, you know, I grew as a person. And, you know, before, like, also I felt like I wasn't accepted as well. You know, I had a hard time building relationships with people, you know. But then, you know, since I joined, you know, this program helped me, you know, grew like that and like helped me build relationships with everyone. You know, I'm a nice person to everyone. I'm known as a clown to most people. So, but yeah, you know, I love this program so much. It's my passion and it's my life, and this I'm dedicated to this.
I'm still kind of a newbie. I just joined, but I've noticed that I feel more confident now that I've joined.
Now we want to start today with a little bit of history about the program we built and why we built it. First, we are called Palante as a way of connecting ourselves to the work of the Young Lords. If you don't know who the Young Lords are, you should look them up, because they're an incredible example of what happens when young people organize their change. They were young Puerto Ricans and other people of color living in New York and Chicago who organized to fight for the needs of their community. The Young Lords started as a street gang in Chicago, but as they became more aware, they began organizing to get institutions like hospitals and churches to be more responsive, to the needs of their people.
We think it's important for people to learn about the Young Lords in school because of the way they do their work. They build support for our social justice movement by providing for community space communities. When the institutions in their own communities did not have these resources and did not give them, they build their own. They provided education, healthcare, childcare, media, food, and clothing in their communities. They're an example of self-determination of youth of color fighting for change.
Okay. So, in our restorative justice work, one of our main things that we are fighting against. You want me to use the mic? So, in our restorative justice work, one of the main things that we are fighting against is the school to prison pipeline, or the way young people are pushed out of schools and into the criminal legal system. we started Palante 2 years ago because of Holyoke High School was and continues to be a place where youth are consistently pushed out of school, especially Latino youth. In 2012, Holyoke Public Schools became nationally recognized because we were fourth in the nation for suspensions of Latino students. Fourth in the nation. And we continue to have some of the lowest graduation rates of Latino students in the state as well. Restorative justice is helping schools keep students interested in school and supported so they don't get pushed out. Across the country, it's reducing suspensions and expulsions and arrests in school. We think this is a good thing.
These peacemaking circles are hosted for young people to solve conflicts, get any support necessary, grieve, celebrate, assist in difficult decisions or transitions, and also solve problems they're having with other peers or teachers. The goals of circles is to get to the heart of the problem and provide support, even if their decisions have hurt themselves or other people. The circles we host allow young people to speak truthfully and also receive help from other youths. They resolve issues without punitive discipline, which doesn't actually solve anything. In fact, just one suspension increases a student's likelihood of dropping out or being incarcerated.
The practice of circle keeping is very sacred to us. It's sacred because it was kept alive by Native people at great risk of their own lives. Our teacher in circle practice, Dr. Sajamito, has taught us the history of circle practice. Did you know that Native people's practices of spiritual practices and circle practices were illegal until 1978? 1978, that's when the Native American Religious Freedom Act was finally passed, and they were able to bring their spiritual practices, including circle practices, out of the dark. It's not right at all. We think using talking circles in school is very important, and if you are going to talk about and use talking circles in school, you should teach the history. To not do so is an injustice to Native.
Alright, so if I were to go around and ask about justice, I'm sure everyone would have a different answer. Justice is commonly referred to or connected to punishment, etc. But the justice that we learn about in RJ is grounded from Native people and have been taught to us through circle practice. So the justice that we learn about consists of three things. One, that we want to make sure that people who are pushing each other away during harm or crisis can come together and we're going to fix the relationship or bond. I'm not saying that you guys are going to be best friends, but I'm saying that we're going to fix the bond so there's no longer, you guys aren't butting heads anymore. Two, we're going to fix the community because we understand that crisis and things like that spiral out farther than just the two people or eccentric people who've been harmed. And then three, we're not going to go just by restoring the problem. We're also going to fix, we're almost going to change what's going to happen in the future so young people don't have to face things like racism, sexism, homophobia, and adultism. We think that if you do not consider these things while doing justice, you're not actually doing justice for the people.
Hey guys. So, in addition to circle keeping, another way that we fight for justice in our school is through community organizing. Even though people want us to leave school ready to compete against each other, we believe it's important that young people have a sense of community. Community. And that they unite to fight for change. So far, we have focused on changing our in-house suspension room into a student support room so that we can get to the root of discipline issues. Before, it was known as the student support room. It was known as the in-house suspension. I was in there myself, I was in trouble. I was there taking tests, so I'm good. I was making up a test because freshman year I was out for a month and a half, and due to some personal issues. And I was in there, there were some students in the back, and we had a teacher in the front, there was a desk, and the teacher was just sitting back, relaxing, watching videos on his phone while the students in the back were munching on food, and just talking really loud, not doing anything at all. They were just chilling, not doing anything. If they were to get in trouble, in class on purpose and just go there just to chill for the rest of the day. Like, there's no discipline in that. So, but we changed into a storage program, so like if you were in trouble and you know if you had something going on in your life, you could just come in with us, sit down and talk to one of the therapists in the room, or we would have one of the peer leaders from the program and you just talk to us and we'll be there to support you. Normally, if you need like just like a reset, it's like 15 minutes, or you could just come in, relax, you know, you could do some work, but after 15 minutes, you feel like you're cooled down, you could just go back to class and, you know, be settled. But yeah. And then another thing we have focused on was challenging the presence of police in our school. Yeah, we have an officer walking around in our hallways. Some people will say for a good reason, others feel it's not really necessary to have a police officer with possibly a loaded pistol and handcuffs on him at all times walking the halls in our school. Like, to me, I feel weird. Like, I feel like I'm in prison, just always like 24/7 being surveilled by a police officer. Like, if I were to make one mistake, next you know, he's pushing me against the wall, trying to arrest me and put me back in his car. So, yeah, it's pretty crazy. Like, a lot of things, you can, minor offenses in school, you can get arrested for. I bet most of y'all didn't know that. Yeah, like, if you were to, let's say, get sent out of class, you could possibly just get arrested, just for that. It's crazy, but this is the truth. And this year, we are researching the different ways racism operates in our school and starting a project about how the histories and experiences of people of color can be included in core curriculum at our school. Did you know that even though the school is 70% Latino, most of us don't learn anything about Latino history or culture at school? The only time I ever learned about Latino history is through the program, to be honest with y'all. Like, I not once ever since freshman year till I'm in 11th grade right now, not once in one of my classes did I learn about Hispanic history. I always learned my history through this program. This is true.
Probably the most important thing about Palante is that we're getting married as a family. Unlike a lot of groups, RJ is really diverse. We have students who are athletes, students who are RAAP students who struggle academically, students who have never been in trouble, and students who have. We are ready for everyone. Thank you for listening to our presentation today. We hope you have many questions and support our work.
Just one more reason why I'm really proud to represent the city of Holyoke. So this is our teacher rep, our teacher senators, the doctor's lawyers, and the teacher mayor, and teacher business owners, and people who are going to be fighting for restorative and social justice. And one of the people behind all this is our good friend Luke. Luke, come on up. You want to say a quick moment? You want to say anything? You're going to join the panel. Come on up. I know he doesn't want the man behind both of us. Yes, exactly.
I just want to say thanks for having us, and I don't really have anything to ask these eight brilliant young people, but it's a total pleasure and honor and privilege to get to work with you all. I'm really proud of you. And this is Christopher Medina.
You put me on the spot right now. You really quiet. I just know these young people are in and out of my office every single day, so I've gotten to know them like a family of my own. And diversity is real, what they talk about. Sometimes we've been asked about our diversity in our group, and I think that you can tell just by the beautiful faces in front of you how diverse our group is, and the problems that they go through day in and day out is also diverse. And so I like to keep that in mind because I help kids that have money at home just as much as I help the kids that have absolutely nothing and sometimes need that support themselves. So it's really awesome to see the diversity in the school day in and day out. But I'll let them
Chris. So one of the guests So we're going to the rest of our panel, and I would just say one thing that they mentioned and I mentioned the criminal justice bill. I'm the lead, actually, it was put in on the Senate side, but I'm the lead on decriminalizing juvenile misconduct, quote unquote, in high school. And making sure that if you do have officers in the school, that they're actually properly trained as student resource officers, not just the cop who wants overtime. That I think one of the things that you heard from everybody is that history, as I said before, matters, and that we are often re-fighting those fights, and words matter. I think words matter a lot, and the words that were used up here today really matter. When you talk about engagement, you talk about community building, you talk about movements, and I think one of the most important word changes that we've tried to work on and Palante presented today was, you know, a lot of times people talk about dropouts, and we've tried to change that paradigm and talk about pushed out. So when you talk about restorative justice, you talk about social justice, economic and environmental justice, what a lot of us are concerned about is making sure that no matter where you're from, right, we talk about no matter what part of Holyoke or what zip code you're from, that you have an equal shot to succeed in your life. And I think that's what everyone up here is trying to represent. So again, to all of our speakers here, thank you. Thank you. So, turn it over to see if there's some questions from our audience on any of our speakers to have a little more of an open conversation. Yes, excellent. One thing I'll say is I walk up to her. I will say that our good friends in Amherst contacted our former principal last year and asked, even though the social justice has been on the Amherst High School sort of pamphlets, they didn't actually have a program. So, but yeah, let's take it away. We got it?
They're confirming. All
right, so there was one that because I'm more part of the back, but I'm not. It's weird. But I was supposed to be part of this program as well, which is called First Generation, which is originated and so they brought it to Peck, and it's mainly to deal with all the youth there, just like in Holyoke, but they're starting from, I guess, a different range of students. Like we sort of just started with the high school. So I don't know exactly all about, I don't have the full information, but I feel that First Generation is a very good program, and somebody please tell me. I want to say, I want Emily's support, so yeah, I will support. I support that program because it's doing everything that Restorative Justice is doing, and better.
I'll just add to that, so Peck Middle School, which is next door to Holyoke High, is the main feeder school, is now trying to learn from what we're doing and do something similar. And then Amherst High School is also trying to do something similar, which I think is great because they're considered one of the top high schools in the state, and Holyoke is considered one of the worst, and I love it when they have to listen to our students. My school is an RJ thing, but most restorative justice programs is basically one adult facilitating everything, whereas our model is youth-led and also has a community organizing team, so it's different than what you find.
Now, I say that restorative justice, as almost all three of the people on the front panel talked about, those movements led to legislation. Those words are being used in legislation. Environmental justice is being used in legislation now. So it may have taken 40, 50, 60 or more years, but those things have finally moved their way up. Does somebody else want to add to that first question? Okay, all right. Another question, here we go.
My name is Michael Prince and Jeremy Baker. As a honorably discharged United States Marine, who received meritorious mass while I was in the military, I was an eyewitness to North's cover-up, Oliver North's cover-up, on CIA-run drugs that flooded Los Angeles, Black and Hispanic communities back in the late 70s, early 80s. I am extremely troubled as to just how we as a people can get together to keep our North American journalists, the ones who come forward with such real information, the whistleblowers, we can keep them out of jail. Because in jail, due to political censorship, there is no justice. Political censorship does occur in these states. I did do a year in jail based upon a framework.
First, thank you for your service, and anybody else that has served our country on Veterans Day, thank you again, and to the servicemen and women and to their families. Thoughts on this one? All right, excellent.
Was that great movie that showed the plight of the journalists to try to expose some of that very situation. I'd recommend, there was an article in the New Yorker a couple weeks ago about the Sackler family, the Purdue pharmacy people. That was a courageous journalist who took on a very powerful family in our country and has exposed them for the drug dealers that they are, the people who are really planted the seeds for the modern opioid epidemic that we have today. And one of the challenges when I read that was thinking about all that money that they made off peddling drugs to people and addicting them, that they then went and endowed things like art museums at Yale and libraries at other institutions of higher education. And that money, which is considered philanthropic giving, and it is tax preferred, we have set up a system that rewards this kind of terrible, terrible behavior. So I'm not quite on point with your journalism issue, although I agree with you, but I'm also really concerned about the fact that we have set up, you know, in Jane Addams' day, philanthropy was to living in the community. Her friend was giving her money to help keep that open. Today, we're letting these drug dealers endow a museum at Yale. It's a terrible thing. The one hope I have around journalism and fear is the rise of the internet. So it's much harder to bang down a wall, right, to whack a wall when it pops back up somewhere else. The problem is it's become much harder and harder to figure out what's true and what's not true. So, you know, I'm not going to curse in a church, but there's a lot of BS on the internet. We have to figure out how to create detectors that can, and how to truth squad that collectively so that people know what's true and what's true.
I have no problem taking a polygraph.
Oh, just a very quick comment in relation to the philanthropic things. Back in the 1980s, Ivan Bosky, who was this notorious Wall Street guy,
crook,
essentially, tried to give money to Princeton, and they turned it down. And the line was because they didn't want money that had been stolen so recently.
I do think that we're going to see. I mean, we've heard it now. You know, now all these new words that everyone spoke on: fake news. What's real? How do we find out what's real? You know, looking to those credible sources. I think it's going to become a much more front center topic as at least for the next 3 years as the politics moves forward and people are looking for information and we have the internet and how do we keep those in doubt? How do we keep those in check?
And yes. This is a major issue because it's the Latino community and the Black community in LA that suffered the most because of that.
Absolutely. Yes.
So thank you very much. And this is a really interesting combination of environmental justice and the social justice because, you know, so many people are learning about their identities and just getting the opportunity to learn more about themselves and their communities and coming to this place in a new way. But meanwhile, and those are differences, right? And understanding differences and acknowledging them. But meanwhile, the environmental issues are shared issues, and we all need clean water. We all need clean air, and we all are seeing some of those kind of bedrock issues being rolled back, in part because we don't have a sort of unified swell of people saying we all need clean water. We all share clean air. You know, and part of that is because the different neighborhoods have experienced injustices. So how does that work? How do we bring people together? Because definitely as we move forward with climate change, it's going to be a pressing issue to this generation, is to come together as one, all people.
Absolutely. I think it's interesting, you often hear people say, you know, in the business community or something, there's too much regulation, and then there's this blanket statement, and I say, well, which ones? The regulations that keep our clean air and water safe to drink? We want to keep those regulations in place. Comments, David's pondering.
I think you identified a huge challenge, which is that the environmental justice community and its history are really parallel but not intertwined much with the overall environmental movement that you think of if you think of John Muir, the Sierra Club. And it's only recently that I think the mainstream environmental organizations are realizing that they need to reach out to this other strand that had been there actually all along, people fighting for particularly public health in their local communities. And you know, I think if they neglect those movements, it's really at their own peril, because it's going to remain a very isolated and small minority kind of movement. And in fact, when you look at public opinion polls, even still, climate change, I don't even think it's in the top 10 in terms of things that Americans are concerned about. And in order for that to move up the list to become a number one priority, or even a top three priority, along with war and peace and some of the other things, it really is going to take all of us and all different kinds of people coming together and realizing these intersections, particularly involving environmental justice and all the other kinds of nature preservation work that's been taking place.
Yeah, I was gonna try to reframe a little bit of both questions and see if I can send it back here a little bit. So, you know, I grew up in South Holyoke on Park Street, which is now Clemente Avenue, and I don't know where all of you are from, but as you all know, I mean, in Holyoke's DNA, it's built in, right? I mean, discrimination is almost built into the city. I mean, it's, as was mentioned earlier, you know, the factory housing, the flats in South Holyoke were right by the. Of course, they were communities where you had a lot of businesses. But as you literally go up the hill in Holyoke, it gets beautiful, right? There's these bigger homes and these bigger yards. And we built recently in the last 10 years a trash transfer station. It was not built in Northampton Street. It was built on Main Street in South Holyoke. From your perspective, I mean, environments, your built environment, is that something that you guys are concerned about? Do you think about how, where you live, the differences within our own city?
So I take a course on contemporary issues, and we deal a lot with like how climate change differs from where you live. So I live in the flats personally, and so he opened my eyes by saying that the first location that they wanted to put like a dump, I think it was in the flats, because that's where people who nobody really cares about lives. So like, and it's just a bit insane because you see a bunch of white people live like in the Highlands, and just like you see a bunch of Puerto Ricans, like rare to see white people living in the flats, and it's just a bit.
I'm David Cesarana, and I personally live near the college, which is like, you know, not necessarily the flats, but you can definitely see the difference between the two environments. For example, like if you go down the street, where in my neighborhood you very rarely see any trash, you see a bunch of green lawns. But if you take a stroll down the street, like a few blocks down, then you see trash everywhere, you see like the canals, you see like trash on the outlines of the canals. You can see that there's very compact living, and like there's a lot of like, plus the exhaust, like all the exhaust because of the car, is it doesn't necessarily, like I think, have suitable housing for children, like, and it creates a very bad environment for them.
Absolutely. Holyoke, again, also I think has the highest asthma rates in the state for many years, and continues to. And I think there's been a lot, you know, going back to Europe, there's been a lot of movement around making sure, I know that the energy bill coming out, we've been trying to work on making it much more cost effective to put, you know, solar panels and sort of renewable energy on low-income housing, because it makes a lot more sense someone up in the highlands by the cutoff can afford to put solar panels on their house, great, good for them, but let's get people who are already in a situation where they may not be able to afford those bills, let's lessen those bills, and again, make it much more sustainable. Yeah.
So what the young wards did was, there was like a whole bunch of trash that wasn't being picked up in the communities, was they picked it up all together, and then when they burned it in like the uptown cities where there's like more wealthy people. And finally it started to be resolved, people started actually like getting the trash, picking it up, bringing it to the dump where it's supposed to be, and the city finally picked it up. Instead of them doing it, it was the city. The city finally like took responsibility for what they were supposed to be doing.
I just wanted to make a point. I think I love this topic here. I love it. I being a student of Holyoke High before these guys years ago, and growing up around families like Arab and his father, just been able to see both gentrification through the years. And not only that, just the difference, and now owning a car, being able to go from different, what I like to call it, holiness, like has some boroughs, just like New York, and they identify these communities the way you heard the kids, the Flats, South Holyoke, the Highlands, all these different areas. And I think just this morning, in picking up for you my small coupe, if we're able to look through the window, because I know you have a little window in the back, you can see the differences. We picked up South and the Flats. We were able to go up towards, I don't even really understand what they call your neighborhood. It's over by Sherwin-Horns. I don't know if you guys know where Sherwin-Horns is. It's over by Sherwin-Horns. And then we get to go back down towards, Springdale, where Marcos lives. So all very different neighborhoods, but all neighborhoods where if you turn the corner, very weirdly enough, you have a little very nice place, and then you turn the corner and you have what other people would consider a troubled area or somewhere not so safe for this youth. So I think it's really interesting for them to be able to see that just being in my car in the morning, picking up somebody who's in a classroom but lives in a different type of neighborhood. I had something else, but I just think it's very interesting. It's a Saturday for me. I think it's very interesting though to see the differences in the neighborhoods and how close they are. And I took, this was my example. There's this one neighborhood, if you're going towards the mall, and I'm pretty sure it's still considered Holyoke, and it's Hanush, actually. The family who owns Hanush Jewelers owns a legit part of the neighborhood. It's a street. None of my students knew that this place was like real. And it's in Holyoke, it's legit. If you just go up the hill and go into this neighborhood, these houses are unbelievable. It's like mansions. And I take my kids there because it's, check this out. This is in our neighborhood. You guys can have this. You guys can have these huge houses. As long as you do what I'm telling you to do in school. But in all reality, it's literally right up the hill. It's a 5-minute drive right next to the mall. You would never even know this neighborhood was there. If you've never been there, I suggest you try it. It's Hanush something. It's a street named after him. And I don't even know if the whole family has houses up there, but I know that the houses are humongous, and I'm sorry.
Just one note about Western Massachusetts. We do weatherization and energy efficiency work throughout Western Mass. Western Mass has some of the oldest housing stock in the state. So the kinds of challenges that you're talking about in houses in Holyoke, drive through Orange, Massachusetts and look at the housing stock in Orange, Massachusetts, or drive through some of the other very small rural communities that we have. Falling down housing, not insulated, not safe. In the rural communities, no access to gas in the street, so that they're heating with wood, they're heating with oil, they're heating with whatever they can get their hands on, and the house, and it's just blowing right out of the air. My mother used to say, we're heating the great outdoors, And so, the single best bang for our buck that we could get to reduce our energy footprint would be to build houses that were more weather tight and didn't send the heat all out the side of it. We're hoping to get some more money in to do more deep weatherization work. The feds and the state and the electric utility companies don't pay for us to re-insulate, or replace old insulation, but to do, there's a whole set of things they won't pay for us to do.
If we can get more money to do that kind of work, we can do something about those houses that are not weathertight, where kids are I've got towels stuffed in the window to keep the draft off them when they're sleeping. So, you know, I'm not even sure where that money's going to come from. I think the utility companies have been pretty good at putting some of that money up. We have to push harder to get more of it. Solar panels are the icing on the cake. Let's tighten up the houses.
I think it's you can also see the difference in Holyoke when you drive around, when you see the parks. Right? There's been a lot of parks in Holyoke, and the number of parks that have been renovated over the last decade are definitely mostly above the Northampton Street line. Right? We know about the tofu curtain right over here between Holyoke and Northampton. Well, there's another line in Holyoke, Northampton Street kind of divides, or even Beach Street kind of divides the city in another direction. And I think that the kids mentioned it, you know, the trash in the street. I think it's something that we have to, and I think the young people have to kind of step up and remind our community that, you know, you walk through the communities, as Clarence talked about, there's poverty in Northampton, you just don't see it. There's poverty in our hill towns, you just don't see it as much. And there's something about the optics of Holyoke that people have this different reaction, this guttural reaction when I come to Holyoke. And a lot of times it's just because of the built environment, and that's been something we've really been trying to work on.
It's been a while since I've studied the Settlement House founders, particularly the women who were involved in the Settlement House movement. But one thing I remember very vividly from the readings I was doing about what they were thinking they were up to was a metaphor about the home and how, and kind of their understanding of what was private and what was public. And so their idea about the home was that they could be in a settlement house and settle in a way that was parallel to a kind of upper middle class domestic home. And I think when we think about environmental justice issues, they're thinking inside, they're thinking internally inside the home, rather than in terms of public parks, for example, even though some of them get involved in that later. But they take that kind of idea of their own homes as a sort of way of extending hospitality into what are working class ethnic neighborhoods. And I guess I feel a little ambivalent about that, you know, partly from my own background, but also partly from the history isn't a very equal, it's not a very equal kind of equation of sort of taking your values and imposing them on a neighborhood. I think there are different dynamics today, which I think the restorative justice program people are going to be dealing with. I just guess, having made a few comments that are sort of random, I would love to know whether you guys go to the library in Holyoke. It's just been redone. Do you guys spend any time there?
I go to the library. Throughout the summer, I went to the library because I would go there with friends. At first, I necessarily didn't go to the library. I didn't even, when I first moved to Holyoke, I didn't know there was a library. But I made a few right choices with friends, and I started spending more time at the library. And yeah, it's very nice.
Just to talk about the renovations of the library, I think the library obviously is beautiful. It really is up to date as far as I can tell. My only, and I think that they're getting a lot better at it, they have a sort of an office there just for the youth, and they have multiple youth rooms now available. That's one of the biggest things that I've seen improved. Usually you walk in and you really feel out of place. I mean, libraries are a little intimidating, so to speak. We're always grown up to know to stay quiet and not do certain things in the library. They've kind of changed their dynamic, so to speak. You still need to be quiet, but at the end of the day, you'll know where to go and you'll feel comfortable. Aside from that, the connection between the library and the school system, that is what I'm looking for a little bit more from, but they do have one person in there that's working with the youth that is doing really well and communicating with us and trying to keep in touch with us and letting us know when there are forums or there's somebody going to be speaking at the library or there's a movie series or the tons of these other things. So, Devin.
So, library, I mean, it's like a danger zone. Because the only reason I say that is because I'm not really quite a person. I can't stay still, so I always have to move and I always have to talk. I always have to be doing something. So instead of reading books, I mean, I can read, but it has to be a certain type of books. So what I do have is I have a mentor, and what he does is he guides me, he teaches me, and he shows me books only that will benefit me and interest me in the future.
So, I have one more question. I just want to do two last questions. I just want to do one quick thing. This is another, it was touched upon talking about culture, but just, it's a whole other panel another day. But for our Restorative Justice Youth, how many of you guys were born in Holyoke? Born in Holyoke. How many of you were born in Puerto Rico?
No.
New York? You talk about culture, I think it's despite the fact that Puerto Ricans have lived in Holyoke for now going on 4 to 5 decades, there's been a difference of ownership and lack thereof sometimes, and that's sort of built in now. There's been a lot of migration back and forth and transiency, and so you don't have at this point, as you have, say, an Irish or French Canadian community where someone can say, you know, I've been here for 5 generations, and there's sort of this pride. We're sort of looking and saying, we want new people to come to Holyoke, and that's what they represent. So, last two questions.
Hi. So, my question is about the kids in Holyoke. And it's about how you, are you making progress? I love the fact that you have a goal in mind. You want to keep kids in school, you want to reduce the graduation rate, you have like a very clear vision based on you know, your analysis of the problem. Do other people in your community, specifically the school administration, are they starting to share your vision? Are they coming on board with, you know, the school board, the leadership, people in charge of an institution, and how can that be brought about if that's not happening yet?
Yeah. So you have support. I think it's decreased the dropout, increased the graduation. Do you have support from the administration? Do you feel you have support from the administration?
If you've seen our school in the news, for one of them, it might have been for the assembly that recently happened in early October. The administration did show support for our group during that time throughout the backlash and misunderstood parts of the assembly. So I would say yes, they do give us support.
If there's any other comment from the kids, I do want to add that Stephen's right, who's a superintendent, is very supportive. In fact, last term, he and I worked to find money to keep the program going. Doesn't mean that every teacher and every administrator is on board. And then they're coming from the kids, and we have our last question. Madeline, okay, maybe our last two. Well,
the panel has clearly stimulated a lot of questions. I have a question for the young people with the RJ program. To what extent do you find your peers, particularly those who are poor, who are uncertain about their future, particularly susceptible to military recruitment? I don't want to over-anticipate the next panel, but I'm very concerned about people entering into the military because it looks like that's the better future for them, when many of them would have liked to have gone into other careers and gone on to further education, though military can provide a lever for education too. But I'm particularly concerned in terms of militarism and those attitudes in our country, how you feel and your peers feel about military recruitment.
Anybody think about going into the military at this point? Sophomores, juniors, anyone think about it? Yes, maybe a little bit. Not a bad thing. Go ahead.
Well, they have a tendency to, like, in lower poverty, like in income cities and towns, they have a tendency to like really bring out like army. Like, this is like if you do the Army, you'll go to college for free. So a lot of kids who are low income do end up going to the military to pay for college.
Do you feel the pressure, Jim?
Well, my family has always been in the military, so I feel a lot of pressure.
I wanted to tweet that. In our high school, I have seen the Army, Marines, Navy come very frequently, and I would say it's because of the placement of the school, where in what section of Holyoke it is, and they have I would agree they have a tendency to recruit more of the students who are less susceptible of getting into college.
And wrapping it up here, last question.
Do you know that you get popped out of having your names reported to the DOD by law? Okay. Do you know that your high schools report to the Defense Department the names, I see a head shaking up there, and that you can opt out? I hope you're aware of that. Your names do not have to be reported to the Defense Department, because that becomes a recruitment tool. But I just want to say, I hope you know the impact that you've had on me, and I suspect others, by your open sharing, your openness about yourselves and what you're doing. Thank you.
This has been my dream panel. I've organized in one way or another about 15 conferences, and I've always tried to get a blend of people from government, people from academics, people from NGO organizations, and people who really are just regular people from the communities we try to serve. This has been just a wonderful, wonderful group. And with apologies to Kathy Hajo, who I promised this portrait to, it can be reproduced. I'm going to give this to the Holyoke High School. To remind yourself of Jane Addams when you come and go, realizing that she was one of the founders of the NAACP, one of the strongest public citizens, not just as a woman, but as a person in the 20th century. And she also, if you weren't here this morning, she won the Nobel Peace Prize. But she is an inspiration for all of us. And thank you, Aaron. What a great job you've done helping to organize the panel and conducting it. Thank you all for your questions.